6, monitor 6. Check 1, 2, check. Testing 1, 2, check.
I don't hear anything.
I don't hear it either. Is it even coming out? Check 1, 2. Testing 1, 2, 3, check 1, 2. Lift up that little lid and make sure I got the number right on the lid there where it's on the floor panel. Auxiliary 3. My bad. Check 1, 2. Testing 1, 2, 3.
Hey, Bob. Hey, we can talk now.
Say again.
I switched your mics. You and Suzanne need to switch mics, so sorry.
Switched mics?
Yeah.
Oh, I see.
Sorry.
One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, ten.
Testing 1, 2, check. There we go.
Check 1, 2.
Okay, now we can turn it down a little bit. It's really hot now. Check 1, 2. Good.
Check.
Can I get my guitar down a little bit in this aux 3? It's about this feedback on me. Good. All right, you want to just hear if our levels are okay? In the secret, ready? 1, 2, 3. In the secret, in the quiet.
I want to know you. Well, good morning, everyone. My name's Chris Quinlan, and we're just so happy to have you here with us to worship the Lord today, this very warm day. We hope you are all staying cool. We in our neighborhood yesterday had a barbecue, so we were definitely barbecued. If you're new here, we just want to welcome you. Thank you so much for coming here this morning, and we pray that you would make this chapel your home for however long you are here with us. Our vision for the chapel is to bring in, build up, and to send out, and so we just hope and pray that you would be a part of that with us this year. The call to worship today is in Romans chapter 15, verse 5. It says, "May the God who gives endurance and encouragement give you a spirit of unity among yourselves as you follow Christ Jesus, so that with one heart and mouth you may glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ." Let's pray. Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for another Sabbath day where we can come and worship you. And I pray that we would do that in unity as a family of believers that will worship you today in word and deed. Bless this day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hey, good morning, everyone. I'm Jim Harbridge. I'm from Officers Christian Fellowship and a longtime member here, and we're so excited. We don't have membership here. I've gone here for a long time, and I love this community. I'm glad that you're all here. We've got a couple announcements today. First of all, if you are new, you don't have to raise your hand, but we've got these tear-outs in the program today. If you would just fill that out and tear it off and put it in the collection plate, that'd allow us to connect with you and know how we can be praying with you. Or for you. So this week, Tuesday, is PWOC, Protestant Women of the Chapels, their kickoff. Whoop, whoop. That's 9 o'clock starting on Tuesday. What? 8:30, totally wrong. I can't read the paper with my glasses on. So I can't see any of you anymore, but now I can read. Yep, sure it is. 8:30, right there. One more thing that I'd like to talk about, a barbecue bonanza coming up, a pretty unique part of your year if you're staying here for a year. Ministry event here where we will teach you Kansas City barbecue so well that you will fearlessly do it yourself, and you will use it to minister to your neighbors and your friends. And then we'll also judge you, but judging sounds bad. It's really, we have some really experienced people who are going to tell you, give you feedback on your barbecue, leading to that confidence that we were talking about. And then we wrap it all up with a family meal, and it's awesome. So I encourage you all to come. There are, you maybe got them when you came in, but there's some black handouts on the tables as you come in that have a QR code. Okay, yep, look for it. Next week we'll have a slide up that has a QR code that you could scan if you're interested in registering for that. With that, let's stand, please, and go find somebody that you have not met yet and shake their hands and introduce yourselves for a few minutes here.
like holy water on my skin.
You may be seated. If you'll bow your heads and pray with me today. Lord, as we come before you, just remind us that your forgiveness is something that's so precious to us. It turns our hearts towards you, frees us from our sin, from the burden that's bestowed on each and every one of us, so that we can have true freedom. We just want to pray this morning for each and every person in this congregation. For victory over sin, for boldness in the Holy Spirit, to embody that forgiveness as we go out of this place, to bring the good news of your Son, Jesus Christ, to the world around us. As we continue in worship this morning, we want to pray for Josh as he comes up to share the Word of God, to break the bread of life with us. Speak to something to us through your Word to each of our hearts. Will change us inside so that we can go out and do great things through your Holy Spirit for the kingdom. We pray for the offering this morning as people give from their heart in a form of worship, that the money that gets given in this place will go out and do great things. We thank you for each and every person here. We continue to pray for safety, health, and for those who are students, the ability to continue forward driving hard to do the work that they need to do. We thank you for all these things, Lord, in your name. Amen. We could have our ushers come forward. Please be prepared to give as another form of worship. Amen.
Holy is
If you would please stand for the reading of the scripture. Today's scripture is Luke chapter 15, verses 11 through 20. And he said, "There was a man who had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, 'Father, give me the share of property that is coming to me.' And he divided his property between them. Not many days later, the younger son gathered all he had and took a journey into a far country, and there he squandered his property in reckless living. And when he had spent everything, a severe famine arose in that country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to one of the citizens of the country, who sent him into his fields to feed pigs. And he was longing to be fed with the pods that the pigs ate, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, 'How many of my father's hired servants have more than enough bread, but I perish here with hunger? I will arise and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your hired servants.' And he arose and came to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt compassion and ran and embraced him and kissed him." May the Lord add his blessing to the reading and hearing of his word. You may be seated.
Good morning. It is good to see everyone here today. I'm going to make a quick plug. If you enjoy reading out loud, not just reading in general, but you enjoy reading out loud, I would invite you to consider being part of our scripture reading team. We're trying to build a team of different voices, men and women, from everywhere, walks of life, who enjoy reading and are comfortable doing it in front of people. So if you would like to do that, is that something that blesses you, but also would be a blessing to us, please see one of us afterward, talk to Kathy in the back. We can come up with a rotation. We're trying to do that, and that way y'all can be part of this blessed time that we have each week. So, for those who don't know me, I'm Josh Grimes. I have the pleasure of leading the congregation here. We have our 8:30 and our 1100 services, part of our chapel family here, and we are in a series that we're calling Building Up a Community of Grace. Now, last week, we looked at the first two parables in Luke 15, the parable of the lost sheep and the parable of the coin, and we talked about how Jesus was calling us to a community of radical grace, a community of sinners saved by grace, and how radical of a call in a community that really is. Now we get to the third parable, which is probably, I'd say arguably, one of the most well-known parables in the Bible. Probably, if you grew up in the church, you heard this parable at least once, if not twice, probably more than that. And what we see in this parable is Jesus is really continuing what he started. Now, we're not going to harp on this, but what's interesting is you go back to the beginning when he's responding to the religious leaders grumbling about who he is hanging out with. It says he told them this parable, singular. Not he told them three parables or parables, this parable. So this is really just a continuation of what he started that we read about last week. But what he's getting at now here is something he only really kind of started to address that he packaged into his confronting them about their wrong view of God's community. And that's his depiction of repentance. See, when you step back and we think about it throughout the Gospels, Jesus is repeatedly says, you see at the beginning of Mark's Gospel and elsewhere, where he says, repent and believe in the Gospel, repent and believe that the kingdom is here. And when you really take a step back and look at the nature of Jesus' ministry, his call to follow him, he is basically saying, repent, because if you don't, I have nothing to offer you. In fact, in the 95 Theses that Martin Luther penned, right, the start of the Protestant Reformation, at the very beginning, and I'm gonna just paraphrase it, he basically makes this statement at the beginning where he says, all of the Christian life is one of repentance. Not the Christian life starts with repentance, and then we go on to do other things. All of the Christian life is one of repentance. Now, nobody needs to answer this question, right? How does that hit you in your gut? How does it make you feel when you hear that all of life is repentance? Right? Some of you might have a response of, if you're honest, you may be trying to ignore some sin in your life, so repentance doesn't sound too great right now. Right? Others maybe feel like you're trapped in it. You're trapped in a cycle of repentance, but that cycle of repentance actually feels more enslaving. than it does freeing. And perhaps for many in the room here, and this may be the most concerning one, because it would be like we are more in common with the religious leaders often than we think we do. When I asked that question, if your comment was, well, of course I repent, we may be taking for granted something that Jesus finds far more serious, but also far more life-giving. So it probably is indicative that we should dive into what he is talking about when he is calling us to repentance, right? In our passage today, big idea here is basically this. He is telling the religious leaders this parable and then, you know, climaxing here at the end with the parable of the prodigal son to present the radical nature of repentance that only comes in response to the gospel. And I think he does that so that his followers, us here today, might know, and this is trying to make it memorable here, it's simply this. When we must be good, we can only sadly repent. But because Jesus is good, we can gladly repent. Because when we must be good, we can only sadly repent. But because Jesus is good, we can gladly repent. We're going to unpack that more as we go here with the time that we have. And to help us do that, we're going to look at three things in the text. In this story specifically, I think, help us unpack what we might call gospel repentance. And that is this: one, the cause of repentance; two, the nature of repentance; and then three, the heart for repentance. So again, one, the cause; two, the nature; three, the heart. So let's dive right into the cause. Repentance always has a cause. What do I mean by that? When you go back and just look at the context of this story, right? The story that he is created here, you got to think about the audience. I think for many of us who grew up with the story, this is like an aw shucks, God loves everybody story. But the audience, both the sinners, tax collectors, and the religious leaders would have been shocked in what they heard. The nature of how the characters acted, the events as they unfolded, would have just been honestly shocking, if not offensive, to the crowd. See, remember, when we're talking about this in the context of building up a community of grace, the family unit is the most basic element of community. It's the most basic element of culture. And in an honor-shame culture, this would have been insane. Why? Well, the younger son asks for his portion of the inheritance, which would have been about one-third if he only has one older brother. His older brother would have gotten two-thirds of the dad's inheritance. But the issue is he's asking for it while his father is still alive. It basically connotes him wanting to sever the relationship early, basically saying, I wish you were dead so I can get what's mine. Now, when they're listening to this, they would have been expecting, okay, then that happened, and then Jesus, what happens next? The father beats the son on the way out the door for what he just asked for. That would have been a culturally appropriate. And yet the father in the story graciously accepts his request, right? Now, we also have to understand that in this isn't just a dishonor to his father. It's now a dishonor to the family. And then when you think about the story continues, he goes into reckless, wild living, squanders everything that was given to him, and he does it in Gentile territory, then working for a Gentile master amongst uncleanliness. He is disgracing his nation. Hard sometimes for us to understand in an individualistic culture. So this is not a pretty story about, gee whiz, God loves you. He sets it up so that they are waiting for something to drop. And it doesn't. Right? And most important for us today, Jesus is setting this up to say, look, he just destroyed community, and this is how it gets repaired, and it begins with repentance. All right? So, think about that. Just what am I talking about? Causality and whatnot. When it says he came to himself, there in verse 17, it says he came to himself. Some of you, your translation might be he came to his senses. It's a Semitic idiom that basically means he woke up. A figure of speech to say, ah, I've been in a daze, I've been in a haze, I've been confused, and now I understand something. It is basically pictured as the turning point that begins repentance. See, you think about it, his life, Life happened to him, right? I mean, he made bad choices, but he's not in control of a great famine, so that just made things worse. Life happened to him, and it got to a point where his life just utterly fell apart. The pain was too much for him to bear. It woke him up, came to his senses, right? He realized what he had done, and now he's responding in return. See, fundamentally, in our culture, we like, okay, this is hard, give me 3 steps. Right? Give me something to work through. But fundamentally, what's going on here is repentance, biblical repentance, is never something that we simply choose to do. Like it's a good idea. It's what I'm supposed to do. No, it's never rote. It's never routine. It always has a spiritual catalyst, so to speak, right? It always comes in response to that which happens to us. I mean, think about this. Has anybody in here, if you've been through a season of confusion in your life, you've been in a haze, you've been deceived, or you've deceived yourself, when you're in the midst of that, do you ever just choose to snap out of it? Seriously, I mean, think about that. No, because things have either happened to you, people have had to have hard conversations with you, whatever it is, and God uses those things in his grace to get our attention. We don't just on our own, in our own volition, in our own brilliance, decide, well, this is foolish. It doesn't work that way. Things have to happen to wake us up. And I think we can compare that or connect that just to how sin works. Think about it. The biggest problems that we have in our lives, character flaws, the things that hurt ourselves and hurt other people, are things that we don't see clearly. Right? I mean, and if we're perfectly honest, it's the people closest to us who usually do see them clearly. We just don't like admitting that. Right? And that is what makes the nature of sin and the need to repentance, that was what makes the nature of sin so deceiving. That's what makes denial denial. You don't know. Speaking marriage-wise, right? This happens in marriage all the time. Well, it happens in my marriage all the time, right? Where we're getting into something, and it is so easy for me to see what's wrong with Mary Catherine. And it's easy to see now what's wrong with me, but often I don't want to listen to that, right? Or perhaps what's worse, because what I'm about to say extends the problem over a longer period of time, is she says, and I'm just going to say, I'm not making anything up here, Josh, you are more prideful and arrogant than you realize. And what is my response? I know. And I don't mean like, I know. No, I mean like, I know. Much like, what do you think about repentance? Yeah, I do it. I haven't been awoken to the depth of my pride. If I can very glibly or even matter-of-factly say, yeah, I struggle with pride. But baby, we need to get back to the problem we're talking about, right? And so on and so forth. Others see us. That's why we need community. So that people can be there that God would then use and then through life circumstances and whatnot to open our hearts to see the deeper truth of the truth that sometimes we don't see at all and often we only see on the surface about what's going on inside of us. So to keep going, God uses people, circumstances to wake us up to the reality of our sin. You know, to get us to that point, much like we sang, it's in the text, like to be like, what am I doing? What have I been doing? And then when we get to that point, as we all well know, we can either ignore it, and then the cycle continues, or we can respond to it. Now, here's the next critical question, though. When you do respond, or when you have lately responded, what is then your experience of repentance? I want to be very careful here, because I don't want to be confusing, and I think this is something we need to struggle with. Is your experience of repentance, if you are a follower of Jesus, is your experience of repentance an experience of sorrow and admission of guilt, but one that is coupled with the joy and the security and the assurance of the Father's love and acceptance for you? Or is it an experience of sorrow and guilt and admission of sin that's coupled with really a loss of confidence? Coupled with a lot more self-doubt than you wish you had. Doubt about God's favor and his love and his acceptance, such that it creates this feeling in you, even while you're repenting, that somehow you must get back in his favor so that everything will be okay. Is your experience of repentance empowering and liberating? Or is it more of an experience that you honestly just feel kind of stuck, especially if the sin is something that you're wrestling with over and over again? And actually, this repentance is coupled with your desire to put on a better face around certain people, right? Or to hide parts of you because of the shame that you can't really just quite shake. And so your repentance is driven by those things. See, in 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 10, many of you know this, right? It's, in a sense, Paul's talking about two kinds of repentance. He says that for godly grief produces a repentance that leads to salvation without regret, whereas worldly grief produces death. Right? There's a kind of repentance that leads to life, to an experience of your sanctification, your salvation in Jesus, that has no regret, that doesn't have things hanging on to you. And there's also a kind of repentance, though, that produces a cycle of sin and guilt and hiding and confession, trying to do better, hoping that if we try hard enough, that we'll start to feel good enough. See, worldly repentance is when we must be good, we can only sadly repent. But gospel repentance is because Jesus is good, we can gladly repent. So we probably better wrestle with what that is. Right, so let's go into the second point, the nature of gospel repentance. Look again, diving back into some of the details here, at verse 17 and 18, right? He says he came to himself, he's talking about a situation, and then he says, I will arise and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Notice that there's two indicators here of the nature of gospel repentance. It's what? First, it's vertical. It's an upward-facing thing. And then it's horizontal. It's outward-facing. And we have to understand that biblically, it's always in that order. First, vertical. I have sinned against... He doesn't say I've sinned against Father and against heaven. He says I've sinned against heaven and against you. Now, why does he start with heaven? I mean, honestly, he sinned against his dad. He sinned against his family. He sinned against the local community, maybe even say his nation. Why are we saying that? I think it helps to understand that biblically speaking, right, sin is always first and foremost against a good, holy, loving God. Because of the way he is, because of who he is, because of what he has done, he is the creator. And not just a creator in some sort of arbitrary way. You know, he's not a clockmaker, he's not a deist, he didn't set things into motion. He is intimately involved in every detail of our lives so that any infraction on that detail is a direct offense in him because he designed it to work a certain way. Right? I heard an illustration by Tim Keller once that basically that God designed reality almost like the weave of a fabric. And every sin that we commit, big or small, is a push and a tug and a tear at that reality. It's against him and what he has done and who he has designed us to be. So it is first and foremost against him. A great example of illustrating that in the scriptures is when you think of Psalm 51, right? The famous psalm that David penned in his repentance for the sin, some grievous sin that he committed. Now, for those not tracking, that's right. If you go back to 2 Samuel chapter 11 and 12, you have the story. I'll give you the quick summary. It's basically this. David is king. He's doing well. He should be at war with another nation leading his troops, but instead he's hanging out on a rooftop, looking out over the city, sees a pretty lady, happens to be the wife of one of the soldiers that he actually knows personally, Uriah the Hittite. Bathsheba is there bathing. And instead of turning away and being done with that, he lingers, and then he has some of his folks, he sends them to bring her back. Now, real quick aside, when the king sends for you, do you say no? The separate sermon. This wasn't some romantic love affair that got birthed out of mutual temptation. The king sends for her, she comes. He sleeps with her. She gets pregnant. There, now you have a problem. because he has clearly broken God's law, and even his king can't do that. So now he sends for Uriah to come back, tries to get Uriah drunk, all right, gets him to, so that what? So that he will go sleep with his wife, and then it will just look like it was his baby. Uriah, in his fealty to the king, to the Lord, to his men probably, who can't be back with their wives, refuses to go in to his wife. So after repeated attempts, David finally says, okay, never mind. He gives him a letter, labels it top secret, says, give this to Joab, the commander. Gets back into the front lines. Joab reads it. It basically says this: hey, I want you to do a full-on frontal assault, and then I want you to withdraw, but leave Uriah exposed. So they do. In modern nomenclature, Uriah's gunned down, and that's the end of that. Bathsheba goes through a mourning period, and like a good Hebrew man, David marries her. But then God sends Nathan, who is one of David's trusted advisors, a prophet, to address him, and he does it in a very creative way. Another parable says, well, not really a parable, he says, I got a situation, right? There's a man who, he was poor man, family, they had one lamb, that lamb was like one of their own family members. You got a rich man who lives next door, he's got massive amounts of property, sheep, etc. He likes that lamb, looks good to eat, he's gonna throw a party, he wants that lamb, takes it from them, kills it, serves the people at his party. And David is enraged as he is listening to the story, and he basically says, who is it? He'll die. And then Nathan looks at him and goes, you're the man, and da-da-da, you know, big, big climactic moment, right? But in that moment, that is the wake-up. We don't know how many months had passed at this point that he is in his sin, hiding it, going through probably holy motions of biblical repentance, Old Testament style, etc. But then something happens and he is leveled, and he writes Psalm 51, and in verse 4 it says this. In light of everything you just heard, it says this: against you, O Lord, you only have I sinned. Now that's only possible if somehow, which is true, that God is supreme in all this, that he is connected with all this, that he cares about all this, and any infraction on any of it into the murderous, adulterous degree that David did is first and foremost against him. Gospel repentance, sin, is first and foremost against who he is. He loves us, his goodness, his greatness, his grace that we are smearing. See, we have to understand that broadly, repentance isn't just admitting guilt. It's not saying I'm wrong. It's recognizing something that is sinful and turning towards God. So in a bigger picture, it's recognizing that I am chasing things other than God to give me joy, confidence, love, comfort, control, etc. And it's realizing this is destroying me, and it is against you, O Lord, because it's against the way that you have designed me to be, and more importantly, it's against the relationship that you want with me, because you, turning to him, have said that you are my source of joy. You are my source of comfort. You are, give me the control that I need. You are the one who gives me the hope that I need. So repentance is realizing that this is killing me, and it is against him, and it is against everything that he wants for me, and turning to him for that. And that matters. Why? Because at the end of the day, like we know sin does and everything else, sin does what? At the end of the day, sin makes everything about me. So if I am not in my repentance, turning to the Lord, and I don't just mean in a rote fashion, but wrestling with what I've been turning away from him for and turning to him, if I won't, I will make repentance about me. I can't help it. I mean, think about it, right? When you go through really hard times, and as a believer, you're wrestling with that, and God uses life to wake you up, what's the first thing you want? You want the pain to go away. We hate the consequences of our sin more than we hate who it's against. We see that in our relationships, in our friends and family and marriages and whatnot. Often, the real problem at first is, I don't like the way this makes me feel. I realize I'm wrong and I hate that. But the problem is because then it makes it about me, that actually feeds self-absorption. It actually feeds self-righteousness because now I got to get my record straight again. Right? It feeds self-pity. It actually is not freeing. Right, we see this in counseling all the time. I mean, even if you're not a chaplain, you've seen it with soldiers or families, right, where you got maybe a situation where the wife is threatening to leave the dude, and he is, like, just distraught about it. And so you work through the process, and she's like, well, listen, if you'll work on this and this and this, I will stay. So then what? For the first 2 months or so, it is a game effort, and he is killing it. But then after the fear of consequence goes away, it repeats the same pattern. And it becomes a cycle until finally somebody can't handle it anymore. But we see little versions of that in our own relationships. It doesn't have to be something extreme. Right? And here's the catch. Talking to the religious leaders, it can even be religious. All of that can be coupled with a lot of prayer. With a lot of earnest, Lord, help me. But the truth is, we're struggling with this. We can't get rid of the fear, the guilt, and the shame. In that kind of cycle. But gospel-driven repentance, deep down, it's not primarily just about breaking the rules or about coming around to the fact your life is breaking apart. It's coming to a deeper and deeper, as you're growing in Jesus, a realization that I have broken his heart. I have treated him in a way that goes against everything of who he is, what he has done for me, and who he has made me, whose I am in him. That I've turned to something other than him. See, and when your heart begins to believe more and more, your heart, not just your head, when you, at the seat of who you are, your mind, will, and emotions, starts to believe more and more that your sin is first against God, not just your frustration with how it affects you and how you feel and where you are, but it's against him, it's weird because this transformation happens where you begin to hate the sin more than the consequences. And that's when life change starts to really happen, right? So first, repentance is primarily vertical, but it's also horizontal. I won't spend as much time on this, but we see it there in verse 19, right? In the first part, I have sinned against heaven, but also before you. And just a quick, easy pointer on this is what? In legitimate repentance, in gospel repentance, in biblical repentance, it includes taking responsibility. It includes going to those who we have also sinned against. And there is no blame shifting, and there is no excuse making. You notice, he didn't go up to his dad and says, I have sinned against heaven, I have sinned against you, but you don't know how hard it was being a younger brother to that guy. Right? He didn't say, Father, I've sinned before you, but I had to go find myself to know who I really am. He says, I have sinned before you, I am unworthy. No blame shifting, no excuse making. You go straight to it. You don't attach it to your past or your present or your possible future. It is simply, this is what it is. I got to bring this to you. Right? So it's vertical, it's horizontal. But before we move on, there's something I think critically important that we also have to see here in the text, and it's something we have to avoid, something the Son didn't do right that we also often fail in our repentance. See, in verse 18 and 19, isn't this fun? This is what I love about the scriptures and stories like this. Do you see how he is rehearsing what he's going to say? How many of y'all do that before you're about to go home and have a hard conversation, right? Right? You're like, gotta talk to my wife about this. Okay, I'm gonna say this, and then I'm hoping she's gonna say this, because if she doesn't, you know, and then if we're angry, then we're rehearsing how we're gonna respond. I'm sorry, maybe this is just me, but he rehearses his repentance plan. Right? What does he say there? Starting in verse 18, he says, I will say to him, right? I love it, before you. I will rise and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your hired servants. Now, it's easy to blow right past this. See, what is he saying? The word hired servants, I was looking this up in a commentary, the actual word for hired servants not used that many times in the scriptures. And it actually refers to a day laborer, not like a domestic servant or a household slave who is actually considered part of the family. It's a day laborer who would like live in the town, come work on the property, and go back home at the end of the day. So what's going on here, basically, it's one who totally earns his wages. There's no benefits whatsoever of being part of the family as a day laborer. So he is basically saying, listen, I'm not worthy to be called your son. I know I messed up. I know I did wrong. Just give me a chance to work it off. Give me a chance to earn my way back. I don't deserve to be. You can't take me back in. Give me a chance to earn my way back in. Now, real quick, this is a parable, right? God is talking about our relationship with him. Jesus is not saying that that there's no place for restitution, right? When we hurt each other and stuff like that, there is a place for payback in the sense of if I break something, I need to pay it back. I need to work. And we have whole sections in Exodus where you have laws of restitution. So there's nothing wrong with, and he's not going against proper restitution horizontally. The problem is, we can't do it vertically. There is no way to pay back. In fact, that reveals, we often talk about the difference between a religious heart and a gospel-motivated heart. That's what reveals one way of our heart is stuck in that religious mindset, right? Because a religious repentance looks like this. It says, if I live right, God will bless me. If I mess up, now I make it up to him so that he can continue blessing me. Right? But the problem is it creates this wretched cycle because honestly, when do you know that you've done enough? How do you know if you've done enough to get back in his good graces? See, we realize we can't do anything to earn his favor. We can't do anything to pay for our sin. We all know this. I think even the atheist knows this. We struggle, though, because we're trying to find some way to make up for it. We're trying to some fun, whether it's with God or with ourselves and our own self-acceptance, we're trying to pay back something, right? But the problem is that feeds our anxieties, feeds our self-righteousness. Why? Because, again, I'm having to bolster back up my record. I'm trying to clean up my record. I know it's wrong, but I've got to do something about it. So what then, as we move into the last part, what then does the younger son need in his heart to mitigate that kind of approach that we also need? Now, we start to see this, point three, in the heart for the gospel, looking again at verse 20. He says, as he was approaching, right, when he was still far off, what happens? The father sees him. While he was still a long way off, his father saw him, felt compassion on him, ran and embraced him. So the father couldn't have been in the house peeking out the door. He couldn't have been looking out the window every once in a while. If he's seeing him from far away, he had to have been scanning. He had to have been looking. And what's even better is think about the nature of that response. The father, and at least it was probably you or me, if we were really in this kind of a situation, we would be like, let him come to my porch and let's see what he has to say. This better be good. But what does he do? He runs to him. Now, understand something, another cultural deal. The audience is listening to this. They're like, he has the gall to come back home. And then the father runs to him. You got to understand, Middle Eastern patriarchs don't run. It's shit. Why? They got to pick up their skirts and run. Only women and children run. I'm being serious. So it is a shameful thing now. It was shameful for him to even give in to the son's request. It's doubly shameful that he's running to him. And what happens? He falls on him. That's the idea of actually it falls on him, embraces him, kisses him. He refuses. And you read the rest of that. We didn't put up in the text today. We'll get more into it in the coming weeks. He refuses to let him finish his repentance plan speech. And he refuses to let his son earn his way back in. How do we know that? He gives him the best clothes you give of a family member. He gives him a signet ring. That basically was saying, you are now back in the family business. Remember, religious repentance is, if I'm just sorry enough, God will love me. I'll be better. I'll be okay. But here we see that it's God's love that then enables the son to repent. I mean, think about this, right? Romans 2:4 says what in God's kindness is what leads us to repentance, right? Try, if you have to close your eyes because that's what it takes. I'm too distracting up here waving my hands around. imagine being the son in that far off position. So he sees him from far away and he sees the house. Whether he can see his dad or not, I don't know. He's seeing, and can you imagine, I mean, if it was me at least, the fear I'm starting to feel? Will he even listen to me? Oh, he's running towards me. Is he going to assault me when he gets to me? Maybe that's what the crowd was waiting for. He's just coming to beat down. And then instead he falls on him and kisses him. Do you not think that that made repentance a little bit easier? Just imagine that. See, repentance is never a means to an end to getting God's favor and love. It's in God's love and his favor. It's coming to see and experience him as our joy. That is what empowers and gives us a heart for repentance. The father refuses to let him back in by way of earning his way, by way of improving or restoring his record, and restores him fully into the family. Now see, at this point though, like I've been saying earlier, we're at that crowd, we're like, what? That's impossible. If you're not even gonna let him fix his own record, then how can he be brought back in? And Jesus, again, like he always does in his parables, he's teaching them about their relationship with God, but he's also teaching them about who he is for them, right? He's pointing them to himself as the answer. Basically, Jesus is saying this by way of the parable. He's like, you think that repentance is about restoring your record with God, but that's a never-ending cycle of a slow death because it always depends on you. But in the gospel, your repentance connects you back to me. Right? I am the source of your confidence. I am the source of your hope. I am the source of any of the power that you need. Not your record, not your performance, my record, my performance for you. He was telling this parable to these church leaders, to the people around, excuse me, the religious leaders, to show them who he is. But layered in with that, I have to wonder, conjecture, but I have to wonder. He tells them a story about a son who's in agony, rags, almost naked, comes home to a warm welcome from his father. And I have to wonder, when Jesus is telling this, like he does so many others parables, when he's making a point in a situation, when he's healing somebody and responding to questions, what is he seeing his own future? Right, one day at the end of his life, when he's in rags, naked, on the cross, his robe is divided up by soldiers. Instead of a feast awaiting him, he's offered an elixir of wine and vinegar. And when he cries out, my God, when he cries out to his father, the door is slammed in his face. See, religious worldly repentance, no matter the flavor, no matter how we try and couch it, is always a way for us to atone for our own sin. But in the gospel, we see that Jesus suffered for us. He became miserable for us so that we could put on his robe, so that we could put on his ring, so that we'd be clothed in his righteousness. Jesus got the door slammed in his face so that no matter who we are, where we think we are, good, bad, indifferent, when we come home, when we turn to the Lord in repentance, the door is always open. Always open. When we repent, we're remembering what he did for you and me. When we repent, we're coming to ourselves and we're coming to our senses. It's a more and more of us realizing and coming into the wonder of who Jesus is and what he did for us. So that in turn, I don't run to him to become good again, but I run to him because he's good. And when that happens for us more and more, we will notice that the cycle of the same sins that trap us, that find us in that religious repentance over and over and over again, start to lose their power. Now let me close this up with some very brief application. Because how does this now pertain back to us as a community? Last week, we were talking about being a community of sinners saved by grace. What does it mean for a community of sinners saved by grace to be a community of repentance with one another? Well, first, we need to be awakened to repent, right? So that means we need others around us sometimes to be the ones that God uses us to knock us on the head. Right? That's why we're constantly talking about community and saying, hey, please get plugged into a neighborhood Bible study. We're going to be kicking off those in about 2 weeks from now, okay? So mark your calendars. Get into PWC or DTB on Tuesday mornings or in your Sunday school class so that you can form authentic, vulnerable relationships with one another. So that you can be with each other in such a way so someone can speak into your life. Because if you're a Christian, you know you need to get the sense knocked into you sometimes. Right? Now, if some of you have experienced vulnerability, like you've been vulnerable and you've been hurt by that, I have experienced that myself. I heard this illustration, though. It's really good. If you were sick, and we're all sick in our sin, if you were sick and you went to a doctor and he was screwed up, would you just write off all of modern medicine? No, I hope not. So don't write off God's design for your life if you've had a bad experience. But turn to Jesus that he would work in and through the people in your lives. Second, it reminds us that, again, we're all sinners saved by grace. So we need this community. We need to be a repentant community so that we understand and we can be with one another so that we can have others around us who are both bold and humble. They can put our feet to the fire when they need it, but they do it in a way that's gracious, that's generous, that's gentle, that's patient, that's understanding. Why? Because they too see that they're a sinner saved by grace. And deep down, it's not just in our heads, but deep down in our hearts more and more, I actually believe that I'm not better than you. Think of how that softens the blow, just like the fathers embraced it. And finally, remembering that as a community of repentance is not primarily a call for us to help each other stop sinning. That's like doing this in the turning process. No, the call is to go from what we've been chasing for joy to our source of joy. The call in a community of apprentices is that we are encouraging each other so that we would turn to find our joy in Jesus, that we would fight for our joy in Jesus. Right? You don't want to run away from something if you're not running to something. Otherwise, you're aimless. Help each other find joy in Jesus. Don't just be sin sniffers who beat each other up when you screw up, but show each other how Jesus is good. Because he is good, we can gladly repent. What kind of community do you want to be, even just for this year? Let's pray. God, thank you for this time. Thank you that you have, that you never give up on us. Like the Father portrayed in the parable, Lord God, you search and you scan for us that you might bring us back in, that even when our repentance has mixed motives like the younger son did, like we do, that you would embrace us so that you would awaken and unlock it and you would bring to fruition the coming to the senses that you caused in the first place, that we would see you for who you are. So please help us in this way. Help us be a people who believe in your grace to our core. Help me, Lord God, to be someone who believes in your grace to your core so that I would love my wife well, that I would love my kids well, that I would love those around me well as you love us well. You are good, Jesus. Help us to believe in you. In your name we pray. Amen.
In the secret, in the quiet, I want to know you more.
Thank you guys again for coming. Again, the curtain's parted. We have donuts and coffee ready for you. We'd love to spend some time afterwards to be with you guys. Next week, we'll be hearing from Leon Buchanan. He'll be bringing a solo message for us, I think from Genesis, so we're excited about that. And then after that, 2 weeks later, for the 2 weeks following, we'll continue the rest of Luke 15 to find out what God has in store for us there and forgiveness and some other important themes. So may the Lord be with you this week, helping us to be a community of sinners saved by grace who are glad to repent to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Go with him. Have a good week.